Hi, I'm Matthew, and I host the Sci-Fi Podcast. It's a place where I criticize movies and TV shows. And my sister also helps out, stuttering along the way through a handful of undercooked thoughts about who was funny and who wasn't. This is our YouTube debut. Welcome, and today I want to talk about everyone's favorite movie of 2016, Suicide Squad. Okay, not that, but let's talk about Moana. Moana is pretty good. I like it. It's one of the movies that I'll frequently go back and enjoy watching. You know, Moana's a great character. The visuals are really cool and fun and colorful. And Tamatoa is really fun too. And this was back when Lin-Manuel Miranda actually made some good music. But there are three areas where I think this movie really falls short. Number one, the first act is really bad. I actually enjoy the first 30 minutes, mostly because like the songs are really fun, the visuals are cool, and the world building is interesting. But if you think about it for more than like 12 seconds, it gets pretty boring. First, we get an exposition dump about Maui stealing the heart of Tafiti and dooming the entire world. Then we get an amazingly cute scene of baby Moana in the ocean, which I like, but after that, it kind of goes downhill. We get an exposition song about how water is evil and being conservative and traditional is good and everything. Then we have an exposition flashback about how the chief's friend died in a storm. Then we have a weird exposition like fever dream via drum that like helps tell us about the people of Motunui and how they used to be voyagers. And then after that, we get the classic I Want song from Moana, telling us all her feelings and motivations. And after 30 minutes, there's five scenes where we grind everything to a halt for a bunch of information being thrown at our faces. Number two, Maui is useless. The legend says that someone will find the heart of Tafiti, deliver Maui across the sea, and restore the heart. But there's no real reason why Maui needs to be there. At the end, he's just a glorified distraction to like help Moana do the real heavy lifting and restore the heart. Plus, because of Maui, we have to go on this like 20-minute detour to the realm of monsters to retrieve his fishhook. And I usually let it slide because it gave us Tamatoa. Great character. But if you think about it a little bit, there's no real good reason for Maui to be in this movie. Number three, the Maui and Moana relationship isn't that interesting. This movie is built around this one trope, the unlikely partners who team up together to accomplish some big, tall task and ultimately become friends and like learn important things from each other. You know, you see it everywhere. You see it in Hawkeye and a bunch of different properties. But we never really get these fun scenes of them bouncing off of each other. They usually talk about plot stuff, and then there's that one scene where Maui talks about his tattoos and Moana's like, oh, I think you're cool, and then Maui's decades of trauma are like just immediately solved. So here's my little rewrite of Moana. I'm going to try to solve all three issues, and I kind of like what I ended up with. So trust me, or don't. I'm just a film school reject, so what do I know? And you know what they say, those who can't do, make YouTube videos. So let's grab your popcorn and relax. Pubby Studios presents a Matthew Tsai production. Moana. So in my version of Moana, we open up with the mom speaking and telling the story of Maui. And this is pretty similar to the original. Tafiti has a heart and the sea monsters want it for the power of creation. And one day Maui comes and steals it and Taka appears while he's leaving. They fight, but here's the first change. Maui kind of realizes like, oh shoot, I can't really beat this lava demon monster thing. So he kind of abandons the heart in the ocean and flies away with his hook intact. And then the rest is the same. The world slowly starts to deteriorate and the little prophecy is born. One day, a special chosen one will find the heart, return it to Tafiti, and save the world from inescapable death. But nothing in this little prophecy talks about Maui whatsoever. Then we cut to baby Moana, who's listening to all of this, and then she asks,
where's Maui now?
Cut to a hawk flying through the air. Then it transforms into Maui, and Maui lands on an island. Not Motunui, just some random other island in the sea. And villagers are there to greet him, they cheer him, and Maui brings them coconuts or something really cool. Maui shows off his fish hook, you know, transforms a little bit. You know, the usual crowd-pleasing, shape-shifting things that people do. And then they shower him with gifts and applause, and they're saying, thank you so much, Maui. And we get our first new song called Thank You, Maui. And Maui is basking in all this glory. So, Lin-Manuel Miranda, this is all on you. I am not a songwriter, so I'm not going to even try to attempt one. But we'll just say that Lin made up a new song for this. Basically, it's just showing how Maui is active. He's this hero and celebrity in the world, and everyone knows him, and he helps everyone across the world. Then Maui leaves the island, and while he's flying, he kind of passes over this one island that's almost completely decimated and deteriorated, and he heads home to this small island where he lives all alone. Maybe there can be like a few stick people that he has built for company. Basically, we want to show that Maui's this active figure who everyone loves for being this cool hero demigod, but he is lonely and he's an outcast. He's living alone, he's broken, and he's kind of sad about it. Anyways, we head back over to Motunui and we have the song Where You Are. This is a song that was in the original, and basically it's kind of the same thing. Moana grows up on Motunui and we see that water travel is forbidden and all that jazz. But unlike the original song, Moana actually wants to do the chief things from the beginning. She's excited to help her village, and in the montage, we can kind of see her helping out people get through the pain of tattoos, playing with babies and kids, and helping people weave baskets. She is really good at this whole being a chief's daughter thing. We want to establish that she's like got a good heart for people, but we also see that she longs to sail out into the sea. And here's a little thing. In this video, when I say sea, I mean the regular ocean and bodies of water that we have in the real world, you know, lifeless. And when I say the ocean, it's this weird thing that has a mind of its own, has kind of the sentience, and also likes Moana. So just for clarification, ocean equals this weird kind of like movie thingy. Sea is just regular dead water. So in the original movie, the struggle between having a passion for the sea and doing chief stuff is kind of mutually exclusive. It's an either or. And here, I kind of want to make it both. Moana loves to help the village, but she also has a suppressed passion. She's not as vocal about it because it's against the rules, and she doesn't want to really anger her dad, so she kind of keeps it under wraps. But she still really, really wants to go. But also, yeah, here's another change. Grandma, her, she's dead. She doesn't exist. She got run over by her Tamatoa or something. But, you know, it doesn't really matter. The thing is, I love Grandma in the movie. She's really cool, and the relationship that they have is, you know, sweet, it's meaningful, but this is a movie that wants to be about Moana and Maui sailing across the ocean, and they're trying to do this unlikely partner thing, right? So if we're trying to do this, then Moana and Maui need to have a stronger relationship. They need to be the ones who teach each other lessons and help each other grow. The best relationships are the ones where both parties make each other better. It's like a symbiotic relationship, right? But in the original, since Grandma existed, Moana's story time is kind of split. Maui's for like the regular plot stuff, like let's get the hook, let's get the heart, all that jazz. And Grandma is more for the emotional growth, like, oh, who you are and stuff like that. So we're going to get rid of Grandma and give Maui all this emotional stuff, trying to solve that third problem that I had there. Anyways, we're still in the song Where You Are. And during the song, we also kind of see the little bits in the background of Motunui struggling, slowly deteriorating. The coconuts are rotten, you know, the fishing traps are coming up empty. It's the usual stuff that's kind of in the movie already. And since Moana is already helping out with the chief things, there's a lot of pressure and stress. So one day she kind of just wanders out to the shore to think and, you know, clear her head. And then she has that interaction with the ocean. But this time she's 16 years old. The ocean befriends Moana, kind of gives her the heart of Tafiti. And so now Moana's like, whoa, she remembers this story from her childhood and she goes to her parents. But this time it's not like in front of the entire village, because I think it's a little stupid when characters have conversations in front of people that should definitely not be hearing it, just so it can like increase tension or create more public panic or like start some part of the plot. Like in Spider-Man No Way Home, spoilers for that movie, Peter talks about like, oh, you know, if we send back the villains, they'll immediately die. And they say that right in front of all the villains, giving them a say. Like, you shouldn't probably not have this discussion with them involved. You should be having this in like an enclosed room with just you and Doctor Strange, right? It just doesn't really make sense. So in this one, Moana kind of pulls her parents aside and they talk in private. And so she says to her dad,
"We can stop the darkness, save our island. We can take the boats, restore the heart of Tafiti."
"Water is evil. That's not a heart. That's a rock. And rocks won't save us. No one's going out on the boats."
"But I can do this. We need to do this."
"When I was young, I heard about the legend too. I tried to find the heart. I sailed beyond the reef. I went with my buddy, Filiberto. But the sea is dangerous and terrible. Filiberto died that day. I couldn't save him. No stupid legend is worth that, no. End of discussion."
"But the ocean chose me. It's a friend of mine. It wants me to save Tafiti."
Moana's dad just scoffs and then he chucks the rock away. But Moana's determined. She believes that this is the only thing that can save her island. But also, this is kind of like a combination of the two things that she loves, you know, helping people and the sea. So she like rushes over to the trees to find the rock. And then we kind of get this song, How Far I'll Go. Basically, it's the I Want song, right? And then she decides, okay, I'm going to head out to sea with Pua, which is, yeah, that's a little thing. Hehe does not exist either. Like, bye. I hate him. I don't like him. Pua is so much cuter and cooler, and there's like even concept art of Pua on the boat with Maui and Moana and Hehe. So in one draft, like Pua was probably supposed to be in the whole movie, which, I mean, guys, come on, merchandise, think about this. Pua is the cutest thing ever. It's my Disney Plus like profile. So yeah, this decision to keep him on the land was terrible, and I'm gonna fix the original's biggest mistake. Pua is going on the adventure with us. So that's the end of our act one. We've established our two main characters, and we have our goal: save the world by returning the heart to Tafiti. Moana believes that she can do it because she has been chosen and she has the ocean on her side. And Maui is this hero that's kind of lonely. And we don't know everything about him yet, but we'll kind of know. So on to Act 2. So Moana sails beyond the reef and she quickly struggles because, well, you know, spoiler alert, she does not know how to sail or wayfind at all. I really like this aspect of the original, how Moana is pretty confident and strong and good at a lot of things, but she's hopeless when it comes to doing what she's always wanted to do. I like that. It feels very realistic and just genuine. So anyways, she's about 2 seconds out of the reef and boom, a storm hits, rocky waves, all that jazz, and she struggles and she's about to drown and Pua is about to fall off the boat and die and all that stuff. And she battles through the storm, tries to like pull the sail and paddle and whatever. And she barely makes it. Pua and Moana are both exhausted, just really worn out. And when it finally clears, she kind of spots a nearby island. And she's like, okay, oh, finally, she'll head towards it. But then she's going to be attacked by this large sea snake monster. And boom, we have another problem. And here's the thing. In the original movie, Grandma kind of says that when Maui stole the heart, darkness fell, and then now the sea is more corrupted with monsters, and they began to attack the boats more and more often, right? And so the seas became more dangerous, and that's why the people didn't really go out and sail anymore. But, like, in the movie, Moana is only attacked once by the Kakamora. And they're not really, like, monsters. They're more of, like, a traveling gang of coconuts, and they're more like pirates than monsters. So in this version, the whole Voyager's backstory, like, doesn't exist. I don't really think the legacy and ancestors thing was very fleshed out in the original. Maybe it has more to do with, like, the Polynesian culture and the connection there. But I just don't really think it was well executed or very interesting. So I'm kind of getting rid of it. So anyways, the same thing happens with the monsters attacking more often. And we're going to stick to it. The sea is going to be infested with monsters. So Moana has a lot of obstacles to overcome during this movie. So Moana is immediately attacked, and here's another time when we can learn about Moana. Action is pretty cool, but I think that most people think that they like action a lot more than they actually do. I think the best action sequences aren't just when like people are doing cool punches and flips and stuff. The best action is when we learn about the story or learn more about our characters, where scenes are doing two things. So here, Moana is going to be extremely flustered at first and like almost on the verge of freezing up. But then she sees Pua in danger, almost in the reach of the sea snake, and then she jumps into action. And everything she does from this point on is to protect Pua in this fight. We're showing that she has some fear, but she's also driven to protect other people. She's kind of heroic. And obviously, she's not in her element. She's not a good sailor or anything. And she's not going to really win this fight at all. So she's always on the back foot. And just as the monster is closing in to eat Moana, Maui flies in. He rescues her and he chops up the monsters into little bits with his fish hook. And he masterfully, you know, gets control of the boat, kills the monster, gets Moana, Pua, and the boat all to the island. And boom, we can take a breath. Moana, after a little bit, she thanks Maui. And Maui, in his like celebrity persona, says,
"You're welcome."
They're going to do some small talk, you know, kind of like they did in the beginning of their relationship in the real movie. Nothing about tweeting, though. Don't like that line at all. And here, Moana's going to immediately not like Maui. He's the reason why her island is suffering, her dad's friend died, and all this other stuff is going wrong. So she's going to be kind of mad at him and sort of abrasive and hostile. But Maui, you know, he's going to be Maui. And he learns that, like, she's from Motunui, an island that he's never visited before. And he tells Moana, like, oh, this is who I am. And then we get into a little song, "You're Welcome," you know, the classic Dwayne Johnson song. And he offers to escort her home. But Moana's like, no. First, she hates Maui. Second, she has a mission. She was chosen by the ocean to restore the heart of Tahiti in order to save her island, right? So she kind of still needs to do this. But then a little idea pops into her head. She knows that she's not very good at sailing, and she also doesn't really know what she's doing in this, you know, monster-infested water. So she demands Maui to come help her. It's his fault that all this is happening, and he should be the one to help fix it. And Maui, obviously, he declines. He tells her he stole it for the puny humans. They're so ungrateful. And Moana is immediately annoyed, saying that he's trying to avoid responsibility and push aside the things that he should be doing. But then Maui says, to get to Tahiti, they need to get past Taka, the biggest, greatest demon monster of all time. And that's basically impossible. There's no way that's ever going to happen. Then we have some funny little banter. Moana tries to convince Maui. Maui calls her a princess. And Moana's angry at that because she's not a princess. She's the daughter of the chief. And then Maui says, I'm done. You can get home yourself. Good luck on failing your mission. And this is basically a little bit where we get basic tension between two people who don't really get along at all. But like in the original movie, Moana tells him, oh, if you do this, you will be a hero. And currently, you're just the guy who stole the heart of Tafiti and messed up everyone's homes. But Maui can be the person who puts the heart of Tafiti back and brings life back everywhere. And then suddenly, Maui perks up at that. He has this little tiny look of seriousness for a second, then a mischievous smirk. And then he accepts. He says, sure, he needs to be a hero. That's what we think. But then he kind of asks Moana, what's the plan? And we realize that Moana has no idea where to go. She doesn't even know where Tafiti is. So Maui takes charge and he charts a course. And just as they head out, boom, they're attacked by more monsters. This time it can be the Kakamora. They're after the heart and we have this big fight where the heart bounces around and our favorite pig, Pua, grabs it before it falls into the sea. And then we can have some more fun banter and jokes and stuff in between them while all of this is happening. And now, just like in our first fight, we want to use this as an opportunity to learn about our characters. So Moana is going to be a person who grew up in community, a community that looks after each other and they support each other. But Maui, he's always been this lone hawk, right? So Maui is not used to fighting alongside someone else. He's just off kind of doing his own thing. But Moana has his back. She understands blind spots and how to help other people. So she covers his back. She's able to multitask and keep track of her teammates, you know, Pua and Maui, in ways that Maui just isn't used to doing. And Maui's this loner, but he is still a very, very experienced and skilled warrior. On the other hand, Moana's kind of flying by the seat of her pants. She just has this paddle and she's just swinging around really fast. So we kind of differentiate them here. And then midway through the fight, the Kakamora hognap Pua. Moana, Maui, and the ocean fight to get Pua back. Moana goes onto the boat. She attacks them with the paddle. The ocean tries to change the tide and keep the Kakamora boat from getting away. And Maui shapeshifts into something smaller and tries to sneak around to get to Pua. But they're overwhelmed, and Pua still has the heart of Tafiti. Eventually, Maui is hit with one of those sleepy blow darts. And so Moana has to make a choice. Does she keep going after Pua, or does she allow Maui to kind of get destroyed by all these coconuts? She decides to go save Maui, another heroic choice that's selfless, and then they retreat to the boat as the Kakamora leave and flee with Pua and the heart. So now our goal changes. We have to get the heart back. And because of these blow darts, Maui is unable to move. So he reluctantly teaches Moana how to sail and actually wayfind. And this is like the same scene in the original where Maui says that, oh, you're not supposed to like high-five the sky, and how Moana sticks her hand in Maui's pee and he, you know, smiles. All good fun stuff. And then Maui tells her that the Kakamora are bandits that work for the evilest pirate in the world, Tamatoa. And he tells her they need to sail to the realm of monsters. And now we have a real reason to go to the realm of monsters. It's just not a side quest about getting the hook. It is the quest. So now they reach the realm of monsters and have a similar conversation as they do in the original. You know, Maui asks Moana why the ocean chose her. Maui kind of belittles this and discounts it. Moana is hurt because she believes that she's this chosen one. And for whatever reason, Maui doesn't really like that. So Maui keeps on saying mean stuff. Moana doubts herself and wonders if she really was the chosen one. And Maui kind of boasts and says that, oh, the gods, they created me, the demigod, and chose me to be the bridge between the gods and humans. I have real purpose and I have real skills and stuff like that. So the conversation blows over and they reach the realm of monsters. And I think this is the part in the original that was really wasted, because the realm of monsters should be super cool, but we only meet Tamatoa. So now we're going to have this new sequence. Maui tells Moana that Tamatoa is a big pirate down here. Not the biggest monster, but one of the big, well-respected ones. And he has minions and people who work for him everywhere. And also, humans are almost never around in the realm of monsters. So they need to sneak around and knock out random monsters and make sure that the word doesn't spread that humans are down here while they try to get to Tamatoa's lair. So this is going to be a little fun segment of Moana and Maui trying to sneak around, but soon they got kind of found out and they're going to have this chase scene where they battle and evade all these kind of monsters, you know, maybe half shark monsters, half pig monsters, plant monsters, everything that you could think of. They're down there and they're chasing Maui and Moana. Here, they start to work together really well, and they're clicking on all cylinders. Maui is looking out for Moana's back, and Moana's getting a little bit better at fighting, and Moana kind of calls on the ocean to help them out and slow down some of the monsters, and Maui transforms into some animals and distracts the monsters and knocks some of them out, and they finally get to Tamatoa's lair after defeating all these monsters. And here we see the Kakamora are also hanging out at Tamatoa's lair. And my thought for the Kakamora are they can kind of be the minions for Gru here, but for Tamatoa. And maybe Pua is tied up and Kakamora are playing volleyball or something with Pua as the ball. So basically, they're going to split up here. Moana's going to go rescue Pua, and Maui's going to try to stealthily steal the heart of Tafiti off of Tamatoa's back. Moana has a relatively easy time doing this. The ocean helps out. Water comes down, splashes, and drowns all the Kakamora. Then Moana hops in, beats them all up, and unties Pua, and they kind of escape. And then meanwhile, Tamatoa quickly figures out that Maui is here. And these two guys are going to be big rivals. They trash talk, and they throw insults at each other, and then they fight. And this is going to be similar to the regular fight. But instead of trying to get the fish hook, Maui just wants to get the heart that's on top of his back. And soon, Tamatoa gets the upper hand, and we get into the song, Shiny. Tamatoa beats Maui to a pulp, he taunts him for being unwanted by everyone, and Moana kind of sees this and she's like, wait, what is this? So while Maui's just dying out here, Moana distracts Tamatoa with a fake heart of Tafiti and they flee the lair. The Kakamora and Tamatoa are right on their back and Moana tells Maui to transform into a hawk and get them out of here. But Maui is somehow unable to shapeshift. His fishhook has stopped working. And he can't get them out of the realm. So they frantically run around and then finally catch a geyser and escape. Back outside, Maui is really, really shaken up. Moana asks him about one of the tattoos on his back, something that she heard down in the realm of monsters, about the woman throwing a baby in the ocean, because we heard the lines in Tamatoa's song. They went like this.
Far from the ones who abandoned you, chasing the love. But your honor's just not hard enough. Maui, now it's time to kick your hymen. Ever seen someone so shiny? Soak it in, cause it's the last you'll ever see. Say la vie, mon ami.
Maui says he doesn't want to talk about it. He does the whole none your business line. But Moana keeps on prying and prying and prying, and she wonders, like, is this the reason why his fishhook isn't working? Maui's obviously annoyed, and in a big outburst, he tells her that he's not a demigod. He's a human. He wasn't this great chosen one. His parents hated him at the first glance, and they abandoned him. And then the gods found him, picked him up, and gave him a fishhook, and gave him meaning. And now, everything that Maui does is for the humans, hoping for their love and approval. And then, boom, something that's new in this story. He reveals that he can no longer shapeshift because the fishhook is dead. Tafiti, one of the goddesses who helped craft the fishhook, doesn't have her heart, so life on Earth is slowly dying. And the exact same thing is happening with the fishhook. And he says that without the fishhook, he is nothing. There's nothing he can bring to the table, and there's no way for him to be loved. And now we see the real reason why he wants to get the heart restored. So this kind of contextualizes everything that we've seen Maui do before. He helps bring coconuts because he wants people to love him, and he also accepted this mission just so he can preserve his fishhook. And also, he gets mad at Moana for trying to be this chosen one because he has never been chosen. He doesn't know what that feels like. Moana recognizes this, and she tells him that he's a great person. He's funny. He's a great wayfinder, a great hero, a great warrior, and he has great hair. And he's all of these things without his fishhook. She says that Maui's parents were so wrong, they made a huge mistake because they'll never get to see what she sees in Maui. This great, great friend. It's a little touching moment, but Maui doesn't really accept this. He brushes this off. It can't be. He's still really mad and emotional. And in a defeated voice, he tells her that all life is being drained, including the sentience and the power of the ocean. Now here, this is the midpoint, something that the original didn't really have. Usually a midpoint is a major plot point in the middle of a movie, and it can do a wide variety of things. It can change the genre, like in Parasite. It could be a huge twist, or it can be a realization, or it could just be a time when the stakes are heightened and the urgency ramps up. Here, our stakes are heightened. Maui has lost everything that he has, and he is now extremely motivated to restore the heart so he can have his fish hook back up and running. And now we have some more urgency as well. There's a ticking clock. Moana now must deliver the heart while she still can, before the ocean dies and all that power goes away. Even though they're still not on the best terms, Maui and Moana are both on the same page. They need to get the heart into Tafiti's chest. So they take off for the island, and now Moana is copying Maui, who's really just diligently working and trying to keep his mind off things, so he's silent and doing this wayfinding stuff, and Moana picks up on some of those skills. And as they travel, we can have a little montage where they banter. Moana slowly chisels away at Maui's really sad exterior, and they banter, they talk a little bit, they have some fun, and they're starting to become real friends now. And then, boom, they are attacked by another monster. Now, this action scene is a little bit different, because Maui can't transform anymore, and the ocean's power is really fading, so they need to work together, use their skills without their special powers or abilities. They struggle at first, with Maui being angry, but Moana starts to pull her weight. She's good with sailing now, she helps hit the monsters a few times, and she saves Maui's back. So, working together, they kill the monster. And now, morale is way up. Moana saved his life, and Maui really admits that she is special, and maybe the gods didn't choose him, but the ocean definitely did choose right. She is special, and it's a little nice moment between the two of them. And finally, they arrive at Tafiti's island, and they see Taka up ahead. They give a little knowing look at each other, and then Maui launches himself forward and attacks with his fish hook. The ocean helps shield a lot of the fireballs with the little power that it has left, and Moana tries to sail through the entrance toward Tafiti's island. But Maui is slowly losing the fight because Taka is just too powerful, and the ocean is struggling to keep up. It can't keep shielding Moana from every fireball, and it's really now just losing all of its power and its life. And now, Moana can't even steer the boat without the ocean's help to cut through the stormy and wakey waters. And Maui realizes this, so he tells Moana, you should retreat and turn around. But Moana believes that she can make it. The ocean still has a little bit of power in it. It can help. So Moana surges forward. But at that moment, the ocean dies, fails, and loses its power and sentience. It's dead. And Moana is barreling straight toward the entrance. Taka winds up, throws a fireball at her, narrowly misses, and Maui sees that she's winding up again. So he leaps in front of Moana and tries to save her life. He takes the brunt of the shot, and Maui, Moana, Pua, and the boat go flying away from Taka into the sea. Cut to black. Then Moana wakes up after a little while, and Maui is still passed out. She sees that Maui's fishhook is completely obliterated, and he has a lot of burns and bruises and bloody marks on him too. And here is the big kicker. When she turns around, she sees that Pua is dead. And now, okay, I get it. This is probably something that would never happen in a movie that is made by Disney, but I really want this to happen. Now she realizes she's in the same position as her dad. She believed she could do it because she was chosen and her dad wasn't. But now she failed. She tried to save the world and her friend has died. She was warned about this in the beginning, and she realizes that she wasn't holding this together at all. The ocean was the one that was the key to their success. And she realizes she's not worthy enough to do this mission. So now, totally defeated, Moana is just done. Moana talks to a dead ocean, and she says that it was wrong to choose her. The ocean chose wrong, and Moana is the wrong person for this, because she cannot do it. She tosses the heart back into the sea, and then she begins to row away from Taka, but then the oar stops above the surface of the water. She can't bring herself to do so. And she leaves the oar there, hanging above the water, and she just breaks down into tears. This is the lowest moment. She has failed and she has nothing left. But then Maui wakes up and he genuinely asks what she's doing. And Moana tells him why and what she did with the heart. But Maui tells her that that is simply not true. He says,
"The last few days, I've seen you battle the strongest demons and monsters in the world. You saved my life, and that was all you. If you can be a hero without a fish hook, so can I. And because of you, I know who I am. Do you know who you are?"
After hearing that, Moana has this big realization, and then we get the song, I Am Moana. I really like this in the original movie because Moana realizes that the call to help her people and go save the world is inside of her. It's not something that's out there. And she learns that her strength comes from herself, not the ocean calling her. So this is the same thing as the original movie, with a few words probably changed because the grandma's not there. She's gone this far. She's a trailblazer. Her people have never sailed like this before. And maybe the ocean has befriended some other people, but they gave up, and she's going to keep on going. She's the only one who keeps on going because she knows she can. She knows she has the strength to do it. So she swims to the bottom of the sea, and she retrieves the heart. And together, Moana and Maui, having learned the worth of themselves through each other, are going to go towards Te Ka without the ocean or the fishhook to help them. And they are determined to succeed because they believe they can. So now we have take two of the fight between Moana and Maui and Te Ka. They work together to maneuver the boat through the waves and dodge some of the fireballs. They splash some water into the air to try to keep Te Ka at bay. And they get closer and closer to Te Fiti's island. Maui takes a few hits to buy Moana enough time to get to Te Fiti, and Moana is unable to find Te Fiti. She's like, what? What is this? And then she realizes, as she sees Te Ka fighting, that Te Ka is Te Fiti, just like in the original movie, just corrupted because she doesn't have her heart. And now she knows who Te Ka really is, so the goal changes again. Get close enough to Te Ka to put the heart back into Te Fiti. Moana sails back into the fight and joins in and helps Maui. She tries to fight Te Ka and get back up to her chest to restore the heart, but it's just not working. They can't get close enough. And just before Maui's about to get killed by Te Ka, Moana decides to do something different. She holds up the heart and gets Te Ka's attention. And here we finally see her growth. In the beginning of the movie, when she first met Maui, she had preconceived notions of who he was. And by seeing who he truly was, she was able to understand and love him. And with herself, she was trying to complete this mission with the wrong mindset, that she was this chosen one who's special because of it. But she realized that she can restore the heart because she is strong and powerful on her own. So with Te Ka, she's going in with the wrong mindset, or the incorrect bias. She sees Te Fiti as this big monster who can only be changed through fighting and through force. And now she realizes that Te Fiti isn't a monster. She's just someone who's lost and has gone down this wrong path. So Moana meets Te Fiti with love and understanding instead of anger and force. Moana is able to see people for who they really are. She's able to see the good in people, like she's seen with Maui. And since the ocean is dead, sadly we don't get this amazing slow-mo shot of the waters parting and Moana walking, which that sucks, but we're going to get Moana back on her boat, and she slowly moves towards Te Fiti with the stone up in the air. And Te Ka / Te Fiti recognizes this. And then Te Ka / Te Fiti starts walking towards Moana. And this is going to make Te Ka go into the water, which hurts her and damages her. And I kind of like the idea that embracing who you really are sometimes means that you need to leave your comfort zone. And it hurts a little bit, just like it hurts to know that maybe you're not this extraordinarily special person who was chosen for a reason, but you still have merit and worth. And basically, Moana sings Know Who You Are and returns this heart to Te Fiti. The ocean is revived and the islands begin to heal, but Maui still doesn't have his fishhook power because the fishhook has been destroyed. The two get to the island of Te Fiti, and Maui, he says sorry for stealing her heart, and Te Fiti offers Maui a new hook. But after looking at it for a little bit, Maui declines, saying that he doesn't need it anymore. And this is a minor change that I think works pretty well, because he's letting go of the symbol of his suffering. Even though it was his greatest strength, it's also tied to his greatest sufferings, and he realizes that he doesn't need it. And now he's going back to what he came into the world as, just a regular human. He's getting a fresh start with a fresh perspective with someone who actually cares and loves him, Moana. And then Te Fiti gives Moana a new boat and she goes back to being this mountain, and Moana and Maui return to Motunui and everyone reunites and everyone's happy. Maybe they have a little funeral for Pua or something. I don't really know what they do in Polynesian cultures, but maybe Pua's spirit can go out into the sea just like Grandma's did in the original, and maybe Pua's spirit follows them as they voyage. So now, a little bit of closure. Maui becomes a new part of the village, finally finding friendship and community, something he's always been lacking. And then Moana becomes a leader and the main wayfinder, leading her people to a new thing, voyaging. And we have that final song, We Know the Way, but it's Moana who sings it this time, not Lin-Manuel Miranda. At the end, Maui has learned that he can be loved for who he truly is, and Moana is a wayfinder who believes in her own strength. And this is Pubby Studios' Moana. So that's my rewrite of Moana, and by no means is it perfect at all. I think it's just like a little bit better here and there, and if you got to this point, thank you. I really appreciate it, and this was really fun to do, and I do want to reiterate that I really love the original movie. Everyone behind that movie is very, very talented, and this rewrite video is like nowhere close to what they're doing, so it was just a little bit of fun. And while you're here, maybe you should go check out the Sci-Fi podcast. We review movies, and I have a review up every Monday, and Isabel and I do reviews every other Friday. And we also have some previous episodes that aren't movie reviews, and it's where we talk about a specific topic each week, and we even have an episode called Nelson Mandela versus Sex Positions, so that's kind of cool. You should go listen. Yeah, do that. And yeah, I don't know how much this is going to be a regular thing. I do have a few other ideas for videos, but I don't know when they'll come or if they'll come. I'll just try to see how much I like doing this. Maybe it'll be a one-time thing or a recurring thing once in a while. So who knows? But thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.